Did you know that there are a pair of outdoor ping pong tables in the heart of Manhattan where people who are homeless play against Wall Street bankers? We'll discuss this and other interesting facts about table tennis on this episode of The Curious Professor. Everyone, I'm Dr. B. Welcome to the Curious Professor podcast, where I take listeners on a journey of discovery to explore the people, places, artifacts, and natural wonders that spark my curiosity. In this episode of the Curious Professor podcast, we'll be speaking with celebrity professional ping pong player Wally Green. But first, a trivia question. In what year did table tennis become an Olympic sport? I'll have the answer for you at the end of this episode. I'm thrilled to have Wally Green in my podcast today. He's a professional ping pong player, hip-hop artist, and entrepreneur. When I found out that Wally represented the United States in more than 35 international pro tour competitions around the world, including traveling to North Korea to play ping pong, my curiosity was immediately piqued. I hope this interview with Wally will spark your curiosity too. Welcome to the show, Wally. It's great to have you here. You've stated that you went from not being able to play table tennis to being a professional player overnight. Tell us how that happened. How did you get into the sport?
The fastest version of that story is someone paid for me to go to Germany to learn to play ping pong. Because at that time in my life, you know, I was into gangs, you know, I was growing up with domestic violence and I was headed down a really bad path. And somebody wanted to help me and they paid for me to go to Germany. That's how I actually started playing or getting the idea that I really wanted to do this.
And you were discovered by Rockstar Games, which is the makers of Grand Theft Auto, among other video games. Tell us about the ping pong video game that you were involved in creating.
I mean, even till today, it's still the world's first and only real ping pong game where players are actually, the movements are real, the motions are real, everything about it is real. The way I started with this game was I was at a tournament and I was playing against a kid who had just came from China. And as we were playing the match, the kid started, you know, making all this noise, like going, cho, cho. Every time he made a point, he was making noise. And, you know, I grew up in the projects. I was like, all right, you know, I'm going to make some noise too. So I started going, yeah, that's it, baby. That's it. Take him down. Take him down. Some people from Rockstar Games happened to be scouting for people to make this game. So they came out to me and they said, hey, are you interested in making a game with us? And I said, who are you? And he said, do you know Rockstar Games? I said, of course. Grand Theft Auto, man. That's one of the best games ever. So yeah, I immediately like jumped on that opportunity and told them yes. And then it was great from there.
You've stated that you brought a, quote, Brooklyn Project's hood mentality to ping pong. How was that received by other players and fans of the sport?
In the beginning, it was, because now I'm starting to remember now, it's really funny. When I first came to the Pro Tour, right, nobody knew me, right? Nobody knew me. But they knew my mouth, right? Because I would play and I would go, that's it, come on, that's it. I was the loudest person in the Pro Tour, making so much noise every point. And I remember one of my first matches, if I remember, it was in Rotterdam. And I was playing the Dutch Open and I had just lost a match badly to England. And then I lost another match badly to Russia, right? Because I wasn't ready to play no Pro Tour yet. And then I had China, which is the best in the world, right? So the first game, I'm getting destroyed. I think I lost like 11-1. Second game was like 11-2. Like just no chance because China is just that good. And my German friend who's on German national team at the time was coaching me. And we shared a lot of cultural things because I spent a lot of time with him during my time in Germany. And I told him a lot of stuff from like the hood and stuff. Like I used to tell him, yo, just go boop, 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 boop. You know, just do that. Like get gangster. So as I was playing, he told me, he said, Wally, 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 boop, 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 boop. Come on, Wally, come on. And so then I said, okay. So I went in the next game. So I was already down 2-0 and it's best 4-7. So I went in, I made a serve and it was an ace. And I went, boop, 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 boop. That's it, baby. Come on. And the Chinese guy He just like was like, whoa, what's going on? And I took him mentally off his game, and I won that game, right? At one point, the score was 3-2, which is unbelievable for an American to play against a Chinese, you know, at that time. And especially like me, who just started really playing this game. And I was 3-2 against this Chinese. And ever since then, I would use it. And everybody on the Pro Tour would go, oh yeah, we know Wally. That's the crazy guy from America.
I'm impressed with the number of countries that you visited playing ping pong. I know that you traveled to China. What were some of your most interesting experiences that you had there?
I've had kind of very strange experiences in terms of if I went to the countryside, like the very countryside of China, where there aren't really any black people there. And I've had weird experience where, like, I remember one time someone went to shake my hand and then they looked at their hand to see if the black came off on their hand. So I've had a lot of experiences around that kind of thing. I've had people ask me, like, my hair is usually orange or bleach with designs in it, ask me, was I born like that? So that's very countryside, because they don't know and they never really seen, you know, everything is blocked from China. So Facebook and all social media. So people who are like very countryside, they haven't seen anything really. So when I go to the, you know, I have kids pointing at me, like just pointing at me, like, look, you know. But yeah, I mean, I've had a lot of those kinds of experiences. I've also had a lot of great experiences, you know, also being a black guy that plays ping pong. You know, China's number one sport is ping pong. They're the best in the world by far. It's their number one sport. So wherever I go and I play, it's assumed that I'm not good, right? Because I'm American. Americans can't play the sport. And then when I go and play, then it's like, whoa, everybody's like, hey, come see this. You know, come. They call their friends. Come look at this. Yeah. So I've had a lot of great experience like that as well.
So it sounds like you were a cultural ambassador in addition to being a sports figure.
Yeah. Pretty much, because a lot of the things that people would say to me, they would be like, oh, we didn't think that black people can play table tennis. You know, for them, it's basketball and football, you know, so they get really shocked. I tell you a funny story. One time I went to, what I like to do on my spare time when I'm not training, I like to find the local ping pong clubs. So I practice at the pro level. So it's usually going to be with the university team or with the provincial team. But I try to find the local ping pong clubs, like all these people there. Have jobs, but some of them are quite good. Some of them played before, and I would go and hustle people like that. Like, that's my thing, right? Because they would look at me and not even believe. But I remember one time I went up and I asked them, I says, hey, and I was in the ping pong hall and I said, hey, I want to play ping pong. And they said, oh, basketball downstairs. I said, what? I just said ping pong and basketball doesn't even sound alike. And immediately, like, they just didn't even hear the word ping pong. You say, oh, basketball downstairs. And I said, no, ping pong. Yeah. So those are kind of experiences I experienced when I'm in China.
Yeah, that's really interesting.
A lot of them are fun.
Yeah. It sounds like a lot of cultural misperceptions.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely.
And you also traveled to North Korea. You said that your goal in going there was ping pong diplomacy. What was your experience like in North Korea? And do you feel like you made a difference by traveling there?
My experience in North Korea was, I think in my eyes, from what I wanted to accomplish, it was pretty amazing. I mean, when I went to North Korea, I just wanted to do my own diplomacy for world peace. You know, in 1971, when Nixon was the president, America established relations with China through what they called the ping pong diplomacy, right? So hence you got the movie Forrest Gump, that's kind of based sort of around that time. I wanted to do my own diplomacy, my own historical diplomacy. And I saw that North Korea was having a tournament. I kind of knew that nobody else in the world would go, except like maybe China, Syria, Vietnam. Like, those are countries that would go. But I wanted to go because North Koreans, for them, Americans are the devil. You know, we're bad and we're hateful and every negative thing you could think about, that's how they think of us. So I say, you know what? I want to go to North Korea and I want to go try and make a difference, right? Because I feel like if the Taliban was sitting next to me, like, they would still be cool with me. You understand? That's my personality. Like, I just make people like me. And so I decided I would go there. I didn't know how I was going to do this diplomacy. I had no idea of the plan or how it was going to work, but I just knew what I wanted to do. So I got there. I'll skip a lot of the story. I got to play a match against a North Korean, which was really lucky for me because I could have played a Syrian and someone from China, but I got someone from China and someone from North Korea, which is great. So as I'm playing this North Korea player, You know, I'm fighting, you know, making my noise as usual. And every time I win a point, there's about maybe 3,000 to 5,000 people in watching. And you gotta remember, they're all North Koreans because there are no other people in North Korea. It's all North Koreans. So it's me against the country. And being American at that makes it even worse. So I start to win points. Like I go up 5-0. Every time I make a point, the sound was the most craziest thing that you've ever heard. It was like, Now picture 5,000 people. Every time you make a point, make a sound that goes like, like almost like, no, that's not supposed to be happening. What's going on? And so it was really crazy. It was so weird, right? So anyway, so we start playing. I get a little distracted. And the North Korean player takes a point. As soon as he takes a point, they start clapping. I picture everyone clapping at the same time, right? Right? Then he takes another point and it gets louder. Another point and it gets even louder. And it's insane because normally I'm the underdog in this sport. I'm always the underdog. Like this guy's better than me, you know? So it was almost like if he was the underdog and he was coming back. So they start clapping really loud. And then I looked up, right? And I just started like laughing, like smiling because it was just so funny, right? So I look up and all of a sudden everyone looked at me, right? Because they've never seen someone like me unless they've seen Dennis Rodman, right? And if they did see Dennis Rodman, they probably thought I was related to him because of my hairstyle. So they looked and then they started laughing too and smiling. And then I was like, oh my God, I got it. This is how I'm going to do my diplomacy. This is it right here. Forget about this match. I'm not even going to focus on this match. I'm going to focus on the crowd because now I got the crowd. So I would play and then I would look up and smile and then everyone would smile again. And it was like chain reaction. I would laugh, they would laugh, right? So that was the thing. So I was like, all right, cool. I got this going. So we finished the match and the North Korean won the match, right? And when you finish your match, you're supposed to shake hands. Like this is just a sports etiquette, right? So he comes to shake my hand and he kind of doesn't really want to shake my hand, but he has to, right? So he kind of like puts his hand out, like kind of like nonchalantly like this. And I just grab his arm and pull him in and give him the biggest hug in the world, right? And it's so funny because my camera is facing actually my back, which is his front. And in the beginning, his face is kind of like, you know, like, whoa. But then he gets a smile, right? He gets a smile and he quickly, you know, gets out of the hug. But that smile is genuine. That smile you can't change, right? So I figured it. I said, this is my diplomacy. You know, people can't change their minds when something has been instilled in them from birth, right? They can't change overnight. But what you can do is you can plant the seed, right? You can plant the seed. So that's what I did. By hugging this guy in front of all those North Korean people, I don't care. They will never forget in their lifetime that a guy from a black guy from America with bleached out hair with crazy designs in it gave this guy the biggest hug he's probably ever had. And he will never forget this, right? So that already starts the little thing. If a person that's trying to harm you and hates you and is evil and is the devil, will that person hug you like that? Of course not. So that just gets the brain turning and the little mechanics working. And that's how you make change. And I think that made a difference in terms of his thinking about what Americans are and what kind of people we are and stuff like that. Yeah.
Yeah. You had an impact on that player and also on the audience and then on all the people they told that story to.
Right. Right.
You're one of the co-founders of Spin Ping Pong Club in New York. Can you tell us about the club and its mission?
Yeah, so our club Spin is, we say, a ping pong bar, nightclub, social club, restaurant, I mean, event space. I mean, it's pretty much everything. And what we did was we took the sport of ping pong, which is, you know, most people call it table tennis. I like the word ping pong because it's just such a nice, chill word. We took the sport of ping pong and we made it less serious. We made it fun. We made it entertaining, right? So, you know, if you ever go to a normal ping pong club, it's high tension, right? Because everyone there is trying to get better or is a pro or is trying to be a pro, stuff like that. So everyone's high tension. There's really no fun for people who don't really play, right? So we wanted to, but the thing is, ping pong is the number two sport in the world, right? It's number two. Soccer is number one. Ping pong is number two, most played sport in the world. And everyone's played ping pong. I mean, I don't know. I don't really know many people who haven't at one time picked up a paddle and hit one ball. Everyone's done it. So we decided, you know, we want to make it fun. We want to make it something where people can just come and do, you know, and enjoy over some food and drinks and our DJs and our parties. Yeah. And so that's pretty much what the mission is to make the sport social and make it fun for everyone. So anyone, doesn't matter the gender, doesn't matter where you come from. You know, if you come to our club, it's always a great time.
And how has it done since the pandemic started? Has it been doing okay?
Well, of course, just like with every other business, I mean, it's really hard. And then, you know, there was different restrictions in terms of like the beginning, you know, we could open at 25%. And then they changed the restrictions again to where we couldn't have anyone in the building at all, right? And then now, today in New York City, we're back to 25% again. So we're going to open up the New York location. We'll open up actually on the 17th. So
oh,
back
awesome.
To 25%. Yeah.
That's
so
great.
So that's pretty good. You know, it's good. The pandemic is definitely, you know, pretty rough thing, but you know, we're definitely able to, you know, get over it and just, you know, get started again.
That's fantastic. I'm glad to hear that. I watched the documentary called The Tables, which I loved. It was great. And for those of you who haven't seen it, it's about free outdoor ping pong tables in the heart of Manhattan and the variety of people who play there. You were featured in that documentary, and I understand that your company sponsored those tables. Can you tell us a little bit about how you got involved with sponsoring the tables and with the documentary?
So 11 years ago, that's when we opened up the first location in New York City. We were looking for a marketing tool, right? And Bryant Park had really good space, you know, with nothing there. And they also have some other activities. But that particular space, nothing there. And then we approached them, you know, if we could put, you know, they'd be interested in having ping pong table. And so my sponsor is a company called Yola, right? It's a German company, but now it's become an American-owned company. And they agreed, long story short, and the tables wound up getting put there. And it's formed this crazy, amazing community of people that would have never met in a million years. You know, you got your super rich guy, your homeless guy, your former gangster guy, like all these people come together just to play ping pong under these two tables. So the story is just about human interaction and how something so simple as a ping pong table can bring people together and then change their outlooks on other people in other cultures. Now, for the story of how I got involved in it, it's a really funny story, actually. There's not much in this country that goes on that involves ping pong that I don't know about or I don't hear about. So some of my friends who play at the park every day, they say, yeah, there's some guy going around shooting a movie or something. And I was like, oh, really? And I was like, oh, okay, cool. So I never met this guy. One day I randomly went to the park and there was this guy shooting with his camera, just shooting ping pong and stuff. And then somebody said, oh, I think that's the guy that's shooting. And so I went up to him and says, hey, are you making a film about ping pong? And he goes, yeah, I am. I said, well, my name is Wally Green, and I'm going to make this film a lot better. And that's how we started working together. That's the exact words that I used. That's the exact words that we started working together. And I became a very big part of that film, not only being the feature, one of the features, but also helping out with the film. You know, I pretty much went to almost every film festival, represented the film, received awards for the film. I did talks to schools about gun violence and stuff like that because of the film. Yeah, so it was a really incredible journey, which gave me the motivation to do the documentary I'm doing now, which is about North Korea. So, yeah.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yeah. I'm glad to hear that you're doing a documentary on that. That's exciting. You have a video on your website of you and actress Susan Sarandon walking the red carpet together. Can you tell us about how you know Susan Sarandon and how you got to be her plus one for that event?
So Susan is a co-founder of our club. And we met her during the time, like before we had the club, when we were doing our naked ping pong party. So the naked ping pong parties, it wasn't naked. It was just a state of mind. Just about being real, being who you are, you know, with no cap, just like, you know, really enjoying life. And we met her through, you know, through that, through those parties. And she loved the idea. And then, you know, she helped us a lot with getting the first location and stuff like that. And during that video, that was the Shanghai International Film Festival. She was going, and I think if I remember correctly, I might have already been in China. I don't remember, because a while ago, I think I might have been already in China or just coming back, stuff like that. And she asked me, she said, oh, I'm going to go to the Shanghai International Film Festival, and if I wanted to go. And I was like, yeah, hell yeah, I want to go for sure, right? And then, but then I said, and this is show you how cool of a person she is. She's like one of the coolest celebrities you could ever meet. I said, well, you know, I don't do like tuxedos and ties and stuff like that. Like, that's not my style, right? Because back then I hated any, back then I never wore a collared shirt. I didn't like any of that stuff. And I told her, I says, is it okay if I just like, you know, go with my normal hip hop style? And she was like, you can go any way you want. As long as you feel comfortable, it's no problem. Yeah. And then that's, yes. And so it happens. That's why you see me walking with Jordans and some orange Sean John pants with an armband and a bling bling chain and shirt on. Yeah. So
yeah, that's really cool.
That was a really cool time.
What made you decide to start playing ping pong with your cell phone?
So the cell phone thing came, I want to say, that was a while ago. That was maybe, I want to say 8 years, maybe, or maybe longer. The way that happened was, is I was doing some exhibitions for the tennis channel. So the tennis channel will have the tennis channel open in Las Vegas. And they would call me out to come do, because they had ping pong tables, and they would call me out to come do some exhibition. So 1 year they called me out, and they had someone that I was supposed to play with who's coming from California. The person never came. So I didn't have anything to do. And I didn't know what to do. I have all these kids that need to be entertained without a partner is very hard. So at the time I had a Samsung flip phone. Remember those? Samsung flip, real small Samsung flip phone. And I was like, you know what? Let me try to play these kids with this phone. And then I realized, oh man, I can actually play with this. Yeah. And so that's how I started playing with the cell phone. And then and then now, of course, the phones are bigger. So now I always used a used iPhone 6S, my old iPhone 6S.
So necessity is the mother of invention in that case.
Oh yeah.
What is more important, skill or the mental game in ping pong?
I think it's equally important, but I want to say mental is a little bit more important. Skill is important, of course. But for example, when I played that guy from China, he had all the skill in the world. Like I wasn't even close to his level, right? But I took 2 games off of him. And not because of my skill, but because of my mental, because I was in his head and I was constantly in his head, right? So he had a weak mental, right? And that's why I got 2 games. Normally he should beat me 4-0 easy, but because my mental was a lot stronger than his, I was able to get 2 games. So skill is important, but I think the mental aspect of this game is maybe a bit more important than the skill.
And you've stated that you didn't feel like you had to be the best player in the world, but you wanted to be the coolest player. Do you feel like you've achieved that goal?
Oh yeah, for sure. Because like all the, you know, it's like if you take basketball, for example, in table tennis. So let's say table tennis was basketball. If you went to Michael Jordan, you say, you know, Wally Green. Oh yeah, I know him. You know, if you went to Shaquille O'Neal, you know, Wally Green. You went to LeBron James, you know, Wally Green. Yeah. So all the top players in the world, everyone knows me because I was bringing that different style. I was bringing like that hood ghetto hardness to a sport that didn't have it at all. I mean, still doesn't have it. You know, it's more of like, I remember one time one of the Chinese national team players showed some emotion after he won the tournament by kicking the barriers, right? And he broke them, but the barriers made out of paper, and they fined him his total earnings. So he didn't even get his earnings. Yeah, it's crazy. I think this was a world championship. He won the world championships, and they said, we're not going to pay you because what you did is bad for the sport, and they fined him, right? He showed some emotion. So, you know, for me, I think the showing the emotion thing and just being real and being flashy, you know, having my hair color change, right? It takes away from me not being as good as everyone else, right? Like when I walk into the hall, they'll be the Chinese national team. Now you remember, this is the best of the best, right? I walk into the hall, they say, hey, Wally, they say, what's up to me, right? Now I'm nowhere near the level they are. So why would they say hello to me? Normally they should be like, oh, this guy's trash, we're not talking. But because I got that cool aspect, you know, I got that hip hop style. And that's something that's not in this sport internationally. Yeah.
But it comes out of who you are naturally and right. Your authentic self. So that that makes it so much more special. You're also a musician. Tell us how you've combined your careers as a professional ping pong player and a hip hop artist.
I've always been into hip hop. as a kid. I did a lot of, you know, opening shows, and then I stopped doing it for a long time, right? And then when I went to Germany to learn ping pong, as I was just hanging around the city, I saw some people freestyling, rapping in German. And I was so shocked because I thought only in America we did hip hop. And I was like, whoa, you guys do hip hop here? And they were rapping, you know, I joined them with a freestyle in English. And they were like, oh, you're from America. And that was the start of me doing music again. So I thought, wow, you know, I'm traveling to all these countries playing ping pong. I'm going to start looking for hip hop while I'm doing it. And that's what I did. You know, I did a lot in Japan. Like I would travel and go play, you know, I would find the hip hop clubs and then collaborate with music with Japanese hip hop artists. And then in China, I would also go and look for hip hop and look for the rappers, right? Then I would go to China to judge hip hop battles and do shows in China and stuff like that. So I just did a lot of international stuff. And then I also created like the world's first hip hop song about ping pong. So one doesn't exist. I made the first one because I wanted to just do it to see if I could do it. It's really hard to write a hip hop song about ping pong. People don't realize it. It's not easy. Writing a hip hop song about ping pong is like writing a hip hop song about school. And my first TV commercial ever was that. I did a short hip hop about a school that I was going to that was all over TV. One of the worst things I ever did, but it's really difficult, but I found a way to do it. And yeah, and it came out pretty cool.
So you took the two hardest topics, school and ping pong, and wrote hip hop songs about them.
Yeah, it's very hard.
Is there anything else you'd like listeners to know about you, your sport, or hip hop music?
I don't know if I can say this, but whoever's listening, I just need one favor. I need everyone to follow me on Instagram. Seriously, because recently it's been crazy. Like I was never into social media. So if anyone's listening, if I never followed you back, sorry about that. Because I just post randomly. I never really liked anything. I never really engaged at all. But during this pandemic, I realized how important it is, especially for me, for myself. So recently with the whole Clubhouse thing, you know, I've reached 1K followers today in under 19 days. So yeah, man. So now I'm trying to like do my Instagram and I'm posting like really good content. Like today I post some, yesterday I post something about what we're talking about me with a video of me hugging the North Korean guy, you know, and yeah, man, that's the thing. Follow me on Instagram at Wally Green NYC. And then after that, I just want to tell people that never give up on your dream. That's really important. Like whatever you feel like you want to do or you think you want to do, no matter how strange it sounds, or just do it. Just go. No matter what people tell you, you just got to do it, man. You go for it. I never thought, if you asked me 20 years ago, would my living be through ping pong? I'd probably hit you in the head with the gun that I was carrying at the time. For real. I'd be like, what are you talking? You'll get out of my face. So, you know, there's many avenues to get to your goal. Try all of them. And then for sure, one of them, you'll succeed in. But yep. That's my message.
It was great to have you with us, Wally. Thank you so much for taking your time to be a guest on the Curious Professor podcast. And now for the answer to this episode's trivia question. In what year did table tennis become an Olympic sport? Table tennis was admitted as a full medal sport at the 1988 Seoul Olympics in Korea. We'll end the show with something punny. Why are fish not good at table tennis? Because they don't like getting close to the net. Thank you for joining me for this episode of the Curious Professor podcast. If there's a person, place, artifact, or natural wonder that has sparked your curiosity and you'd like for me to feature it on the show, please let me know. My website is thecuriousprofessorpodcast.com. If you enjoyed the show, be sure to subscribe to the Curious Professor podcast wherever you listen to podcasts. And if you'd like to become part of my community of curiosity seekers, be sure to visit my website, thecuriousprofessorpodcast.com, and join Dr. B's Hive. Until next time, always be learning and be curious with Dr. B.